The following is an encore presentation of one of many Financial Sense premium programs, which are available every week to premium subscribers only. For more information on premium subscriptions, go to our financialsense.com website and click on the subscribe link provided.
FS Insider, a premium edition of the Financial Sense News Hour. Today's host is Senior Editor Chris Sheridan.
For longtime listeners of the show, you may know that we turned quite bullish on the commodity sector in the early 2000s and rode that all the way up. One of the people that we followed very closely is Barry Bannister, the senior equity strategist at Stifel Nicolaus. And he is one of the first, if not really the main person, who articulated early on in those 2000s the idea of a commodity supercycle and was making some very bullish calls. And so that was a big reason for why we had gone long in commodities at that time. He joins us today. And Barry, you just released a very comprehensive macro and strategy outlook. I think you just released it a few days ago. We're going to go through that. And I just want to make a note that if any of our listeners want to look at any of the slides that we're going to be discussing today, I would encourage you to do so. You can go to Financial Sense, where this interview is located, and click the strategy outlook where it's located there. Barry, let's start with the main theme, I guess. And you say right at the beginning, you have a target for the S&P 500 at 2,500 in 2017, led by the reflation trade. You're looking for the S&P 500 to top out in 2018 with a bear market in 2019. And that actually aligns with a number of other statements that have been made by strategists and economists on our show previously as well. What are your thoughts on that, and how are you coming to some of those views?
Yeah, back in 2014, I had gone up to, I believe, a 2,300 target when we were in the low 2000s, and I was wrong. It was a tough environment. What happened was, if someone's listening and wants to refer to the slides, it'd probably be better. On the left side of page 15, there's a chart that shows what happened. The trade-weighted dollar, which had been repressed by QE, QE3 particularly, surged very sharply. And what happened is it pulled down on the left chart. The green line went up. That's the dollar. The black line went down. And what that was long-term inflation expectations in the market, what they thought inflation would be in between year 5 and year 10 into the future. So that was massively deflationary. And oil, of course, collapsed, and a lot of other things happened. We underestimated that at the time, so we ended up going sideways for almost 2 years. But I've been inching the target up, 22, then 23, then 24, then 2,500, as the Fed seems to have realized they don't want to have a deflationary dollar spike, and they need to wait for the rest of the world to catch up. So the number one thing that's going to decide whether the market can go higher is reflation. In other words, more synchronous global growth, positive inflation, and a Fed exit that's not reckless. So I'm fairly positive. It's not a massively bullish call. It's upside of maybe 7% that I can argue for absent tax reform.
So like you just noted, if we see that target on the S&P 500 of around 2,500 this year, that's about 7% higher from current levels and be about 11% gain for the year. And that's contingent upon a continuation of this reflation trade that has been underway now. Let's talk about this idea of the S&P 500 topping in 2018 and how that would eventually move into a possible bear market in 2019. What are some of the forces and drivers behind that forecast?
I speak to a lot of investors, mostly institutional. And, you know, when you have a fully invested bear or you have the sentiment that is cautious, you know, measures that are technical, such as what's called the VIX skew, V-I-X-S-K-E-W, that is not the kind of environment that I've associated in my 30-year career in the investment world with a top. Tops are usually, unfortunately, occur when there's optimism and things seem okay. The skies seem clear. The Fed is comfortable. Even if they do pause in rate hikes, it's comfortable. There's too much discomfort for me to call a top at this time. So that's part of it. The other is on page 5 of the note. There's that concept that I can elaborate on if you're interested, but it's called the shadow Fed funds. It existed during the zero rate era on the left. The blue dotted line was how low the Fed funds actually went if zero were not a barrier. It's theoretical. It's in the footnote. It's a calculation based on some work from Fisher Black and others. What it is the Fed has been hiking since May of 2014. We're way into a rate hike cycle. We crossed the midpoint of those diagonal lines back in December 2015, which was the sort of the capitulatory phase of that weakness of 14, 15, when the market bottomed out, as you recall, around, I think, January of 16. And so it won't take much. We think 1.75 on Fed funds by 18 to have been too high, too far, too fast. And then within a year of hitting that, you will have a recession. We have a lot of debt, and you have to ask yourself, why has that line trended down over 35 years? I would say it's because debt is deflationary, and cumulative indebtedness leads you to a lower threshold or ceiling for when the Fed is tightened too much.
That's a critical point, the fact that we do have so much more debt. And I think that explains, as you also point out, the lower highs in the Fed funds rate and how that has led to an eventual slowing of the economy and recession. And so we're reaching lower lows. From your chart here, you show that 1.75 is kind of the target when we'd expect a significant tightening, given the amount of leverage that we have currently. And again, that would target a roughly 2019 recession if the historical pattern plays out. How do valuations play into your view? Because I do know you discuss that at some length. You show some interesting charts and data. Tell us a little bit about valuations and how that fits into your return outlook going forward.
Well, the left side of page 5, the whole Fed funds, shadow Fed funds, handoff to the positive Fed funds, and then the ceiling and the debt and the fact that debt is money. When you have a bank make a loan, they deposit the money in your account. That creates new money. Reserves don't create money in the banking system. What happens is loans create reserves. It's an unlimited supply. It reached a practical limit in 08, and I think that the lower ceiling for where rates are comfortable is part of that. Now, if you go to page 3 on the left, what we're seeing in the market, and I'm perfectly happy to ride it, is that low rates, which are a function of this cumulative deflationary effect, as well as Fed rate suppression, a large balance sheet, which suppresses what's called term premium. What you have is low rates, which have been emblematic of this deflation risk, right? You're going to have a Japan-style situation where a low rate at, let's say, zero, could be with negative 2% inflation. So your real rate, zero minus a minus two, is plus two, or a very high real rate. So low rates were seen as borderline deflation, tipping you over to deflation, terrifying. And so there was a wall of worry in the market on the left side of page 3, whereby if you took the earnings and you divided it by a middle grade corporate bond, I use the BAA rated bond, that from 2011 to 2015, the green line, which is the earnings capitalized or divided by the yield, so that's just present value of the future earnings stream divided by, using the BAA yield as your divisor. The market, the black line on the top left of page 3, was always below the green. So the market was like saying, hey, rates are low, but they're low for a bad reason, deflation. So I'm not going to pay up for that. And what you saw really since January 2016 is both the capitalized value of the market as well as the actual market moving up and moving together. And they're converging on each other now. And I think that 5% is a reasonable target for the BAA. 125 is a reasonable target for earnings. And I can get to 2,500, which works out to be about a 20 multiple on trailing by the end of the year, trailing earnings. So when you just cross that threshold, this is the thing, Chris, that I think people miss. When you cross that threshold from worrying about deflation to a little bit of positive inflationary confidence, then the low bond yield goes from being a problem to being a really good catalyst for a high PE. Hey, I'm growing and I've got this low cost of funds. So that's why you have the PE expansion in the market top. Is a lot of it's PE, and then there's some earnings follow through on the cyclical side of the economy, and that puts in the top by 18.
And I think you note here, if you look at historical cycles, that points towards 2017 being a good year, especially when you're looking at earnings per share growth, and then a slowing in 2018. And going to, I think it's slide 20, you look at trailing 10-year S&P 500 total return versus the CAPE ratio, and then also household equity as a percent of financial assets, and Tobin's Q. That was a mouthful, but you can look at the chart. I think those are longer term valuation metrics. What are those pointing to as far as you see with market returns, maybe looking out more than just 1 year or two, but even further out than that?
Yeah. I mean, before we leave it, you brought up the cycles and what to expect. Is page four, on the right side of four, is exactly what you just said. And that's important. When you're looking at the right side, it is the Dow Jones Industrials, which is the only index where you have credible daily data going back over 100 years. So this happens to go back to World War II, ended in 1945. Been 11 business cycles. We know the month that each cycle peaked. And we can take the middle of the month and assume that's the day the cycle peaked. And then we look at how the stock price performance happened two trading years before and one trading year after that peak of the cycle. So the red line on the right is to your question earlier, which was, this market's going to be strong in 17, as is historically normal. We're too far away from recession to really be worried. 18, we start to get a little concerned, but earnings follow through and the market just acts toppy. And then 19, I do expect a bear market and overhiking by the Fed to have triggered a recession, as well as some blowback from Chinese rebalancing, European euro issues, and so on. Now, going to 20, that's just a really interesting exercise. And what it is that three methods, the CAPE ratio, Tobin's Q, and the household ownership of stocks as a percent of their financial assets. Those three methods don't tell you anything about the short term. What they tell you a lot about is your long-term return potential. When stocks are overvalued on 10-year average earnings, CAPE, when they're overvalued on replacement book value, Tobin's Q, and when households have way overweighted stocks in their financial asset portfolios, that pretty much guarantees you're going to have really poor returns the next decade because they're overbought, overowned, overloved. Conversely, when they're underbought, underowned, and underliked, stocks offer really good returns. And that's what that chart does on that page. And we use it with predictive force. And I'm not thrilled with CAPE and Tobin's Q, but I would argue that household ownership of equities is actually the most accurate and the least affected by, you know, dividends, dividend proportion of earnings, and growth. So when you look at the methods that we use, page 51, 52, and 53 of that book go into great detail in the post-World War II period on that method. And I would just draw you to page 51. 51 on the bottom is if you took the average since World War II of Tobin's Q, household ownership of stocks, and the CAPE ratio, and you said 50 equals the average, you get the bottom three colored lines. You're deviating around the average. And so in 1948 and 82, stocks were cheap and underowned. In 1968 and 99, the little circles there in the bottom clip on 51, they were overowned and overpriced. And what that meant was, if you look at the blue line, each point along that line is your trailing 10-year annualized total return, including dividends. So just pick a point. 1948, far left. Nobody liked stocks. Go up the green arrow. 1958, you made 22-21% compound total return for 10 years with the stock market. That's a bull market. And conversely, go to the far right. In 1999, I circled that you had very high valuations and stocks were overowned. And you zip over to the arrow in 2009 at the market crisis low, and your 10-year trailing return, including dividends, was minus 3. So we just simply flip the bottom upside down, since it's a contrary indicator, and move it forward by a decade, since it's predictive, and you get page 52. And 52 just says the blue line was predicted by those three colored lines pretty well, because those are advanced by 10 years. And they point to, because you're advancing them a decade, you already know what they are in 2016. You advance them to 2026. They're saying somewhere between a 3 and a 5. That's your total return annualized from 2017 to 2027 on New Year's Day. I would not tell a pension or an IRA holder to expect more from an index fund than 3 to 5, including dividends, for the 10 years ended 2026.
And that might actually be a problem, given I think CalPERS, their rate of return that they're expecting is around 7.5%. If I understand, that might be around 7%. I know that they had lowered it, but it's still quite high. I think that was the return requirement that they had set right around 2000, given the huge bull market we saw then. So there's still going to be some lowering of expectations, I think, and expected returns when we think about the pension industry.
Yeah, I read an article that most pensions are in that range, thinking they're going to do 7 to 8, and they're not, period. They're just not. I'd be leery of any municipal bond in states that's got huge pension liabilities with aggressive assumptions on return.
Barry, let's talk about commodities for a bit here, because as I noted in the open, you were one of the first that I'm aware of to talk about a commodity super cycle. I'm not even sure if maybe you coined that term. Correct me if I'm wrong on that, but you're definitely one of the first that I knew of to ever speak of such a thing. What are your thoughts on commodities now? Where are we in the cycle, and what are some of the things that you're looking at?
If you go to page 32, there's a good chart. It's the total return. This is price plus dividend of the U.S. stock market index. And I just go to Google, type in Shiller data, and it's there. So S-H-I-L-L-E-R data. It's an Excel file since 1871, S&P monthly, as well as bonds and a few other things. And we link that with the commodity index. All of that's in the footnote on page 32. And it's the total return of stocks relative to the price of commodities since January 1871. And it's oscillated around a trend line, a logarithmic trend line, a log scale. And after a prolonged period of, at first, just a plain full-out bull market in equities, then, not a bull market, but not a bad market. And then, poof, a conflict, a major crash, all kinds of problems. Most of my work, which is in this note, talks about the very long term, the middle long term, and the short term. And I try to cover all three in separate packets. And this forecast on the little inset chart on 32 is where we see the S&P range through 2026. And that's based on that previous page of Tobin's Q, household equity and CAPE ratio. And then the orange line on the bottom right of 32 is your commodity index forecast. So like using our index, where is the commodity price is going? And we're in a secular bear market for commodities. It was really good from 2001 to 2015, and then that's a typical length of time. And then, of course, it's going to be poor for 15 to 18 years after that. Peak in 2008 really was the peak of commodities until the late 2020s. So that's where we're coming from. Now, there's a whole lot more to it, but that chart just kind of summarizes stocks versus commodities.
One chart that I actually thought was pretty fascinating is where you talk about the contrarian cycle, and it looks like there's major peaks in commodities around every 50 to 60 years. I think it's roughly a 55-year average. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Back in 2011, I think it was, around the time that that right chart, which is the rolling 10-year growth rate, peaked, I talked about how, look, guys, the commodity price movement, the rolling growth rate of commodities is coming in for a peak. And this right chart is simply a 10-year moving average of year-to-year change. So each month, like March of 2016 against March of 2015, you have a year-to-year change, percentage change. This is a rolling 120-month average of that monthly series. And the left chart is the actual data. There's no rolling there. It's just the actual commodity price index of the United States since the year 1805. There have been six tops. I put green dots on them. I know the history surrounding each one of those dots and tops and what happened. But by converting the left chart into a growth rate on the right chart, smoothed growth rate, we see about a 55-year plus or minus five. It looks like it's lengthening 5 years per cycle for whatever that's worth. Contrarian wave. And it implies 55, maybe 60 years after 1981, you're going to have an all-time high peak in commodities. So we calculated what kind of a decline in the dollar are we talking about if commodities do 16 CAGR to the 10 years ended, what is that last X, 2037 to the early 2040s, sometime in there. It's a 77% drop in the dollar. And we asked what would cause that. And we figure there's going to be a lot of debt added to pay for the baby boomers who are undersaved and aging fast and vote as a block. And as that is on page 36, the left side of page 36 shows that this is the sources and uses of cash by the government sector of the economy, federal, state, and local. And you can see that they never take on the top part of the left chart more than 30% of GDP from all sources, payroll taxes, excise taxes, personal taxes, corporate taxes. So if government's capped out at 30% take, and then there's all these liabilities coming, on the right side, the retiree-to-worker ratio in blue is going to go vertical. It's already gone vertical. It's going to keep going vertical until 2035 to 2040. Who's going to pay for that bill? So what's going to happen is I think there's going to be an awful lot of debt. And if that happens, then somebody after the 2030s, 2040s, who's in their 20s or 30s, is going to say, well, I finally buried dad and grandpa. Am I going to pay off all the liabilities, or am I going to inflate them away? And that's when you have an incentive to inflate them away. And that's why we did page 37. The right side just shows the actual births, 4.2, 4.3 million peaks. The actual births each year since 1910. If you advance the baby boom peak births around 1958 by 80 years, you have lifespan. And the peak of that liability arc is when there will be an incentive to get rid of the debt, not before, but after, which is why I get a little worried. But, you know, like most baby boomers, I'll be so old, I probably won't care by then.
We actually just spoke with a man by the name of Alan Bollier at ITR Economics, and their forecast for a while has been that we'll see a recession probably around the 2019 timeframe. It'd be a mild one. And then after that, their long-term forecast is for another Great Depression, 100 years after the last one that we saw, the 1930s, around the 2030 timeframe. Now, what you point out here in terms of the baby boomer generation, age 65 and older, and that spiking upwards into the 2030 by the amount of benefits, I believe that they're taking as a percent of GDP, if I understand that chart correctly, that would seem to align partially with Alan Bollier's forecast for a 2030 depression, or at least that's one of the long-term structural forces that he cited, is demographics and how that relates to rise in inflation with high leverage and some of the other factors that would come together around that time frame. What are your thoughts on that idea?
Well, sure. Fright sells. Sometimes newsletter writers, and I'm not a newsletter writer, so I can talk about it. Newsletter writers, sometimes they like to stir up disaster talk because disaster sells. I'm just a pragmatist. You know, I know that government doesn't take more than 30% of GDP. I know that the liability is coming. You know, I'm fairly negative on healthcare in the long term. Why? Because it's the only liability that really, really grows, that the government can't really tolerate unlimited pricing, and inflation would just raise the cost to them of the ultimate liabilities. So therefore, they have to control the cost and price controls would result. So I just see healthcare pricing under pressure for a very long time. And the depression argument, no, I'm not making that. You know, if you call the 70s, which was a great inflation cycle, and it was the previous cycle on that chart, if you call that a depression, I wouldn't. I understand all the economics, Austrian economics and Keynesian economics, and all the aspects of deflationary depression, but I would not say that that is the likely outcome. I just feel like that's pretty far out, and most of my clients are just interested in 17, 18, 19 at the most. And that's why so much of this book talks about that and what we're watching in the short term. I think the Fed just doesn't quite get it, in the sense that they don't realize that they're extremely limited in where they can go with rates. I seriously doubt in the next several years, like 5 years, that they get to anything north of 1.75 on funds. Shrinking the balance sheet, you know, it sounds good in practice, but the problem is mortgage-backed spreads to treasuries are pretty tight, and you start shrinking the balance sheet and kill housing, it's not going to be pretty. So there are really no good options. So in all likelihood, the market's going to follow exactly what you said just a second ago, Chris. It's a good chart. It'll follow this path that we outlined on page 20. The right side of 20, the blue line on the right side of 20 is what the S&P was supposed to be as predicted by that left chart, the Tobin's Q, the household ownership of stocks and the CAPE ratio. What the S&P was supposed to be, the price level was supposed to be 10 years later. So like, you know, in 1999, it said you've overbid the tech bubble. So in 09, you're going to be at around 750 on the S&P. We actually bottomed before that. But you get the idea. In the early 2010, it said you're going to have problems. Back in 2000, you're going to have problems in 2010. So the blue line was the forecast, and the green was the actual. Housing bubble was clearly not sustainable. So when the green line went up on the right side of page 20, it crashed back down in 07, 08, 09. But clearly, the chart shows a final run. We're in the last run of the bull market, and then there's going to be a 20% drop back to the 2000-ish range by 2019. And then you're going to look back in 2024 and realize that you were range-bound, you know, 2,200 plus or minus 10% or so for 10 years. And that's because global rebalancing, savings, investment, U.S., China, Europe, intra-Europe, North-South, Japan, all this global rebalancing is difficult. And so normalizing rates will lower the PE, and global rebalancing will periodically pressure profits. And it's just not going to be easy. So the glory days of equities are done until the mid-2020s, but then after that, we might resume a bull market. We'll see. That's what the chart implies.
So once again, your outlook, given some of the data and the charts that we discussed so far today, is for the S&P 500 to hit 2,500 in 2017, led by a reflation trade, topping out in 2018 with a bear market in 2019. What are some of the risks that you're looking at, you think, that could move the timing of those?
Lack of growth overseas, inability to get any traction that's sustainable in China and Europe particularly, or even Japan. That would be a primary risk, because the main constraint on the U.S. recovery right now, and the fact that the U.S. rates cannot seem to get a lot of traction on the upside, is on page 14 on the left, which is the top left of 14, shows the 10-year yield in the U.S., 10-year treasury. The bottom left shows what's called the G10 ex-U.S., and it's the group of 10 countries, the major Western countries, whose debt trades globally. I mean, China has a lot of debt, but it's traded inside China. It's not global debt. These countries' debt can be bought by you and me in a brokerage account pretty easily. That the Western world debt, excluding the U.S., the yields there have been very crimped. Why? Because you have negative rates in Japan and Europe. You have extraordinary monetary ease. So as they throttle back European Central Bank and Bank of Japan, for example, their QE programs and their rate fixes at negative levels, which are absurd, then what will happen is it'll free up the U.S. yield to rise, and that partly feeds our reflation case into 18. But you know, they still haven't resolved a lot of the fundamental issues. China's trying to do a bottom-up consumption-driven economy with a top-down model that doesn't have rule of law in the court system for property. And Europe is trying to have a currency union with no fiscal union, so there's no real control over budgets other than market forces, and no true national banking union or authority other than ECB inspections. So the world's a mess, and I'm optimistic that it could get a little better, but I think it's just going to be a 10-year process from maybe 2015 to 2025 before we kind of sort everything out, and in between, stocks just get buffeted.
Barry, wrapping things up, would you mind giving a bit of a drill down on your position, given what we've discussed already today, on some of the major asset classes, whether or not that's stocks, bonds, commodities? I think it's pretty clear that you are bullish for the U.S. stock market for 2017. But would you mind just giving a quick recap of some of the financial implications and your outlook for each of those major asset classes?
Well, you know, you start with the premises. You try to figure out where do you want to go on the short term and what are the things that you have to look for to know where the turning points will be. And so like right now, we're long this reflation trade, which we have described, and I won't go through it. It's lengthy, but it's on page 8. It's those top 20 green industries with the word yes. So those are the industries. And then at the very back of the slide deck in the last two pages, it lists the companies that are longs and then offsetting shorts. So that's a trade that we think is good until maybe early 18. At some point, though, you know the 10-year yield will peak. On page 6, there's a chart of that. The best we can hope for, and it also happens to be probably likely because we've seen two bottoms in the 10-year treasury, which is the first time we ever saw double bottoms at the same level. But page 6 on the right shows the 10-year treasury yield during the massive debt leveraging, deflationary debt accumulating 1985 to 2012 period. And so if the 10-year yield trades in a range, you just range trade the equities that are proxies for bonds. So where will you go when the reflation trade, so to speak, peaks and the 10-year yield peaks? We think the left chart, there are two views, and this is it. This is binary. You could speak to bonds, or you could just do it through bond proxy equities. I use REITs, utilities, telecom, staples as a proxy for bonds because they're bond proxy stocks. The green line, we think, is going to go down because the red line is going to go down. That means the 10-year treasury. Notice that that red axis is upside down. We think it goes to 3, and then you buy them for the recession of 18-19, those four groups. Then there's the deflationist who don't think there's going to be growth, that thinks the world, you know, can't get traction, that thinks Trump will fail, et cetera, and they think the 2.4 yield is going to go back below 2, and they want to buy these bonds, utilities, telecom, staple REITs now. I think they're wrong, but they might be right. And so it's a binary decision between those two. So that's the asset classes, stocks versus bonds, of the next 2 years. And the question is global growth, yields, Fed exit, synchronizing of global growth, ECB, BOJ, Japan and Europe exit from their central bank policies, etc. And as for gold, sometimes I get that question. You know, I'm not interested in gold. I think gold's going to 1,100 when oil goes to 56 in the next 18 months. But then, you know, I'd accumulate it anywhere you can get it closer to 1,000, because if we're right about that 2030s, 40s scenario, then gold will obviously do very, very well. But that's a very long time to wait with underperformance. So for me, it's a trading vehicle until it becomes another secular bull. And I don't foresee that until the 2030s. And that was described in some detail, if you're interested in the gold question, on page 26 and 27 of the report.
Well, Barry, I want to thank you for coming on to FS Insider and speaking with our audience. Once again, I want to note that, you know, we have been following your work for decades now, and you have been pivotal in terms of applying a lot of these long-term macro big picture topics and trends and how they apply to, you know, what we should be doing in terms of strategy. You've been doing a tremendous job over the years, and we always appreciate having you on and looking at your work, sharing it with our audience. With that said, would you mind telling our audience a little bit more about how they can find about what you do and the best place to follow more of your work?
Well, I only generally talk to institutional clients, and Stifel Retail Brokerage Network has access to it. So it's an in-house product. I just really like you and Jim, and I'm glad to see that your firm has still got an audience and doing great. And periodically I can come on and we can catch up. But this product, this particular slide deck, I think is posted on the website after this call, Chris. So anybody who can make their way through this 54 pages and not lose their mind like I did trying to write it, I applaud them.
Well, there's a lot of great data, as I said, and a lot of good research that was put into it. So I definitely want to recommend our audience to go through it. And Barry, it was great speaking with you. We look forward to having you on again.
Thanks, Chris. Talk to you later, man.
So again, that was Barry Bannister, Senior Equity Strategist at Stifel Nicolaus. And as I said, we've been following his work for decades. This chart pack is immense. As he said, I think it's around 56 pages, but there is a ton of really good data in here. And as we noted multiple times during this interview, Barry definitely looks at the big picture. He looks at long-term secular trends. So if we're talking about the stock market, he thinks that 2017 is going to be good. We'll see a peak in 2018 with a bear market in 2019. And that was related going back to looking at the Fed funds rate and interest rate cycles, something that we discussed earlier with John Derrick on our podcast. And so Barry thinks that we're going to see the Fed funds rate peak at around 1.75%, and that would be around 3% on the 10-year before we see the economy slow down. So that was one of the things that he cited. Also, when we look at valuations and where they stand currently, he said 10-year returns are quite low. And you can look at the chart that he cited where he goes through that data where they took a look at a number of valuation indicators, including the one that Barry seems to think is the most useful, which is household equity. Equity as a percent of financial assets, that has the highest correlation that they've found to the stock market and forward returns. And so when you look at that data, it points towards, again, a peak in the market around 2018, around a 20% correction into the 2019 timeframe. And then we would be basically range bound for quite some time. And you can see that again on slide 20. If you'd like to find this chart pack and the slides, the way you'd want to do that is just go to our site, financialsense.com, and you can click where it says podcast in the navigation bar and search for the title of this interview where we'll have Barry Bannister's name listed. You'll see his picture listed there. Click the title, and then that will take you to the page where this interview is located with the chart pack. I'm Chris Sheridan. You're listening to FS Insider at financialsense.com.
You can subscribe to Financial Sense NewsHour in the iTunes and BlackBerry podcast libraries, or at feeds.feedburner.com/FSM. Find more information about our guests at www.financialsense.com/newshour. Friend us at www.facebook.com/financialsenseonline. For our on-the-go listeners, you can access Financial Sense on your mobile device at m.financialsense.com. The Financial Sense News Hour is for informational and educational purposes only and should not be considered as a solicitation or offer to purchase or sell any securities. The investments, investment strategies, and investment philosophies discussed or presented on the News Hour each involve their own unique risk factors, which are not discussed on the show. Responses to listener inquiries are based on the personal opinions of James Poplava and do not take into account listeners' suitability, objectives, or risk tolerance. Financial Sense News Hour and its parent company shall not be liable for any financial losses that result from investing in any companies profiled on or advertising with Financial Sense, or arising out of the use of any material on the News Hour. Be advised that you invest at your own risk.
You've been listening to an encore presentation of one of our Financial Sense premium programs, which are available every week to premium subscribers only. For more information on premium subscriptions, go to our financialsense.com website and click on the subscribe link provided.